Welcome to Nursing Research Lecture. In today's lecture, we are going to see a new topic that is very important. Population sample and sampling, the unit name. So once we plan the research design, then we want to focus on our study population and how we want to select sample from the population and what are the sampling process, sampling techniques that we will follow that we are going to see in this unit. So now the concept you must clearly understood between the population and sample. Population is comprising a very large number of units. So each and every individual combined together, aggregate together to form a mass, that is called as population. Population is very bigger. So statistically, the population is represented by the symbol capital letter N, and sample is the portion of that population, a very small part, or we can say subset of the population is the sample. The sample is represented by the alphabet small letter N. So this diagram keep in mind so that population and sample concept you never forget. Now let's see the basic introduction of the population. So basically, the sampling is the process of selecting representative units from an entire population of a study. In our olden days, when we cook the rice from from a pot, to check whether the rice is boiled or not, what our grandmothers used to do, they used to take a small grain of rice and they press and check whether it is completely boiled or not. So when one rice is boiled, they come to a generalization that whole rice in the pot is boiled. So this is the ancient knowledge the people used for population and sampling. So similarly, the process of selecting a representative units from an entire population is called the sampling. Okay, so in a research, every research will have population and sample. So without selecting sample, the research is not at all possible. So every researcher has to identify their population and they need to apply some sampling process, and they will find out what size of sample they need, and they select either by using a probability sampling method or non-probability sampling method. And sampling, in other words, simply we can define it is a selection of some part of the aggregate or a whole. So from the aggregate, for example, 10,000 people are there, that is my population. From that aggregate, I am selecting a portion. I select around 100, or I am selecting around 1000. So that is sample. So basic thing about sampling is that selecting a subset of your population, selecting a portion of the population. So why we do that? So based on that sample, we make the judgment or we make the inferences, and that result can be generalized to the aggregate population. That is what findings we are getting, results, statistical result to the sample can be generalized to the population of our study. Okay, so this is the basic thing. So when you study this unit, you must be able to understand the basic concepts or basic terminologies. First one is population. Population is the aggregate of all the units. So each and every units joined together to make a population in which a researcher is interested. For example, I am interested in doing a research with a postgraduate nursing students. So all the postgraduate nursing students in India comes as my population. Now, what is target population? Population can be divided into two types. One is target population, another one is accessible population. Target population is one which is meeting all the designated criteria. For example, I have one criteria. I select postgraduate nursing students. So my criteria in this postgraduate nursing student is those who know multiple languages. For example, those who can speak more than four languages or minimum four languages. For example, I know four languages. I know Hindi, I know English, I know Tamil, I know Malayalam. So I comes under this category of target population. So anybody who knows more than four languages will be who have the postgraduate nursing degree will be my target population. And accessible population is those who have the criteria what I set and those who are available at the time of collecting data. For example, I am living in Panipat, Haryana. So when I want to meet, I can reach to collect data to some distance. For example, I can go to Punjab, Delhi, Himachal, Rajasthan, nearby states I can go and easily collect the data. But I cannot go and collect data from Andaman Nicobar Island, the sample who is in Andaman Nicobar Island, or the sample who is in the Kerala or Tamil Nadu. So the travel charges may be costly for me to go and collect the data. So I am not selecting them. So even though they are in my population, but they are not in my accessible population. Accessible population whom I can go and collect the data. Hope you got it. The next one is the sampling. Sampling is the process by which we select the units from the population. Sampling is a process. It is what we can say. It is the steps. It is a procedure by which we recruit the sample from the population for our study. That is sampling. Sample each and every unit of a target population which we select for our study is called sample. Mostly, what we can say, Madhula, each and for example, 10,000 people. In the 10,000 people, I want to select 1,000. So that 1,000 people together called as sample. In that 1,000, each and every person will be called as element or subject that we will see in next slide. So on the next slide is element. I told you from the 10,000, I select 1,000. 10,000 is population, 1,000 is sample, and each and every member in the thousand, in the sample is called as unit, or we can say element. So these elements, mostly in our nursing, the elements are human beings. That may be a patient, or maybe a student, or maybe some people in the community. Human beings are the elements in nursing research. So what is sampling frame? A list of samples. For example, in my hand, I am having the list of all the samples, the 1,000 people's, the 10,000 people's name, detail, the demographic variable which I have. That is called as sampling frame. The list of individuals whom I selected as a population. For example, in our college, nursing students, the nursing students of all the classes, all the courses, the list with the age, gender, place. So this is called sampling frame. So by having the sampling frame, we can able to select the sample very easily. The example, other example is pregnant mother's attendance register who is coming for a maternity clinic. So in a maternity clinic, they will maintain a attendance register for all the pregnant mothers. So that register can be served as a sampling frame. So these are the basic terminologies about population sample and sampling. Now we go to the, what are the sampling error? So everybody have a tendency to do some error. So for example, some kind of fluctuation which we get in the statistical values when we do analysis, result fluctuation may be because of the sample. For example, each and every individual is not same. Even though the sample is having uniform characteristics, in something they may differ. For example, the physiological parameter, the body condition, the thinking aspect. For example, the student's attitude, knowledge, practice, everything differs from one sample to another sample. So that proportion of fluctuation in the result of the study is called sampling error. Okay. Next one is sampling bias. Bias means tendency. For example, we are doing some mistakes in while selecting the sample. For example, I want to select samples in two groups. I am selecting those who like very much in a class in one group. Purposefully, I am selecting. So that kind of a mistake, what we do is called sampling bias. For example, equal representation of samples, we are not keeping in two groups. So that is also called as sampling bias. So sampling bias can affect the result of the study very much. Okay. Next one is sampling plan. So sampling plan is like a research design. How we are going to select a specific sample by using what method? I told there are two types of method. One is probability, another one is non-probability. The plan also tell what size of sample I am going to select and what procedure I am going to select. For example, whether I am going to do the random table method to select the sample, or I am going to use lottery method, or I am going to use tossing the coin. So this is called the technique or the procedure of selecting a sample. So sampling plan tells so what method I am going to use, what technique I am going to apply, and what size of sample I am going to take. So hope you understood the basic terminologies. Now we move on to the very important schematic diagram of the sampling. So for your easy understanding, so in the exams you draw this. So the population is a very larger part representing in the size. Okay, the target population, from the population, the criteria which we are applying to the population is the target population. So that may be still bigger but lesser in size comparing to population. The next one is accessible population, that also bigger but comparing to the target population is smaller in size. The sample is very smaller comparing to the accessible population, and the elements are the subjects. From the sample, each and every unit, they are called as subjects. So this diagram definitely you need to draw in the exam. Now come to the purpose of sampling. Why we need to do sampling in the research? There are four purposes. First one is economical. Next one is improved quality of data. Next one is quick study results. Next one is precision and accuracy of data. For these four reasons, we need to do sampling. First, let's see one by one. Economical. So the researcher need to complete his research within the budget he has in his hand. So it is not possible to collect data from the whole population. 10,000 people are there. Within the 10,000 people, I cannot go and collect data because I can lose much energy, more money, and most of the time can be lost in that. So to make the research very economical, so every researcher use sampling process. In that sampling process, when we collect data, we can save time, money, energy, resources, everything. So hope you understand. And another important thing, when we do the sampling, we can generate the empirical evidences very strongly. So what do you mean by empirical evidences? That is the evidence in number. For example, how much percentage we have find out that corona is spreading through droplet, or that is the evidence. How much percentage this is happening, this how much percentage that occurs. So that is empirical evidence. Next one is improved quality of data. So when we collect data from the population, it is very hectic for the researcher to maintain the quality of the research work. So what we want to do to maintain the quality, we need to have sample. So when we collect data, from the sample that is adequate. That sample information is more accurate, more precise. By this way, we can improve the quality of data. Next one is, for example, another example, what we can, a farmer is having 1,000 cows. Maintaining the 1,000 cows is very difficult. He cannot maintain the quality of all the cows. So what he can do? So he can have less number of cow according to the space available in the farm, according to the number of people available for him to work. So that maintain the quality of the cow like that. When we have sample, the quality of data will be very good and accurate instead of having the data from the population. Next one is quick steady result. So when we have samples, the sample helps us to generate the steady results very easily, and it saves time. Easily we can go and collect the data within the time limit. We can complete the thesis. So that is the best advantage of the best purpose of having a sample, to get the steady results. So mostly every research have a certain time period. Every researcher want to find the steady results within the time limit. So having a sample enable the researcher to do the research in a faster way and to achieve the objectives of the research very easily. So that is the next purpose. The next final purpose of the sampling is precision and accuracy of data. Already I told you. So when you collect your data from the entire population, we are going to have voluminous data. Means more data we will have, and that is going to be very hectic for the researcher to analyze more data, more information, and we will not get the precision of information of the data. It is going to be a cumbersome task. It is going to be very, very hectic, very big headache for the researcher to organize all the data. So what we can do, when we collect the data from the sample, it will be very easy. It is going to be very accurate. It is going to be very precise to formulate the result and interpret the result. And it is very easy to generalize the finding. So these are the purposes of doing sampling in the research. Okay. Now we are going to see the characteristics of a good sample. So there are basic four characteristics of a good sample. First one is representative. Second one is free from bias and error. Third one is no substitution and incompleteness. And fourth one is appropriate sample size. So what are the four characteristics of a good sample? First one is representative. So a sample must reflect the characteristics of the population very closely. For example, my sample is nursing student. So that sample must have completed nursing course. My population is nursing profession. So the sample must have similar characteristic of my population. That is the first thing, representative. And another thing is free from bias and error. So when we collect the sample, don't commit errors in collecting the samples, and don't give chance for bias. Okay, sample should have free from errors and bias. Okay, a good sample must be selected following the sampling plan. A well designed plan must be in our hand to select the sample. By having a good sampling plan, we can avoid bias and errors. Next one is the substitution should not be there, and the sample must not have any incompleteness. So every sample which we select must give the complete information. For example, I am going to collect a sample from one nursing student. That nursing student is not present in the home. So I cannot collect the sample on behalf of this nursing student from their mother and father, because that is not a representative of the population. So that will be no substitution. For example, some studies, some sample may, for example, like patient when we take, they might die in between the research process. So that time substitution is allowed. Substitution is allowed. Replacement of the sample is allowed. Most of the time, don't collect the data on behalf of the sample from other person. Okay. And always try to get complete information from the samples. Don't go with a partial information, with a part information. Okay. So that is also wrong. The next characteristic is appropriate sample size. For example, every researcher must use a sampling technique and find out how much number of sample is needed for his or her research. So we have some formulas, some calculation to find out the size of the sample in your research. So according to that, we need to select the sample number. So when we have more sample in the quantitative research, that will give reliable research result. A sample size should not be too much large, too much small. When we have less number of sample, what will be the effect? The study result will not be much reliable one. Okay, so keep in mind the sample size plays a significant role in determining the result of our research. So this is another characteristic of a sample size. Hope you understood the characteristics, and this is the end of part one. So in this lecture we have seen basic terminologies of population and sampling, and we have seen the characteristics of sample and what are the purpose of sampling. So in next video we will see the sampling process and methods of selecting samples. Take care. Bye bye.